Okay, guys, we will start a brand new topic today. Okay, it is the sequential logic elements. It's a very important concept in logic design. If you know, we have talked about all the combinational logic circuits, okay, or the basics of combinational logic circuits, the minimizations, the truth tables, etc. All right, from now on, we are moving to a more complicated design process, which is a sequential design, all right? Today, it is not exactly the full sequential design, but it is the sequential design elements. Like in combinational design, what we have OR gates, AND gates, XOR gates, etc. Okay? So, as the sequential logic elements, we have latches and flip-flop. All right, latch and flip-flop element. So today we will have an introduction for these elements that we will learn the basic behavior of these logic element, sequential logic element, basic building blocks. After, in the following weeks, we will define sequential logic circuits, which means that we can define much more complicated circuits, such as a procedural design, an algorithmic design, one by one design. It means that you do some kind of work at start, then you the other in the next time. So you will have a time domain information. Okay, it was like the previous designs were like two-dimensional, okay? So here now there is another dimension. The dimension is the time dimension. In the previous courses, time wasn't important at all, okay? It is the circuit behave the same all the time. Now our circuit will behave dependent on the time information. And we will also talk about how to give time information to the circuit, okay? So somehow we need to represent the time information. Also, please, all the guys who couldn't join the class, tell your classmates that we are moving to an important topic, so don't miss, okay? So we are in the halfway of our logic journey, so this continuation of the journey is very important. So don't miss the following course. Please don't miss. Okay. So let's get started. Okay. So we talked about that. Especially, we will talk about the latches and flip-flops. Their timing analysis, and we will summarize. Hope to summarize. All of them. Okay. So the sequential circuit concept is something like that. It is the sequential circuit is a the sequential circuit is a steady state output. It gives steady state outputs that are function of the current inputs. This part is the same as our combinational circuit design, current inputs plus the past inputs. So now we have the past information. It means that it is now time dependent. Or in other words, the circuit has some kind of memory. So in order to remember something or do something depending on our previous task, you need to have some kind of memory, okay? So our latch and flip-flop elements are at the same time. What kind of elements? Say, we have an idea. What kind of elements are they? They are actually memory elements, okay? So our circuit will have some kind of intelligence. from now on, all right? So our circuits will do something consciously. They will have some kind of intelligence. Okay. So in order to have a memory and behave depending on the past inputs, we will build feedback mechanism. So feedback concept is a very important concept in the whole electronic design, both in analog design and digital design. So we will discuss the digital means of feedback in this class. Okay. So this course is important, and I assume that the next course is more important than ever. Okay. So because we are moving to a brand new subject driven user. Okay. So we will talk about a new concept. It is a state concept. Okay. State of the circuit. So we will call this state as a vector value. All right. So each element of the state will correspond to one bit. So because it's the binary design, we will divide bit by bit. All right. So here is a very simple analogy between the combination and the sequential. So here, there is a key, okay, if you remember the key or the password, whenever you input the password, then you are done. So it's similar to combination. So if you have the exact combination, then you are done. Your circuit will work or your lock will open, okay? However, in more complex lock designs, there needs to be some kind of sequential input. So you need to have the order of the sequences in order to open the safe, open the key, open the lock, etc. So first you need to put the arrow to the 2 as an example, then 8, then 6, etc. If you don't remember the exact order, then your lock wouldn't open. So here, now, there is the timing information or the information depending on the past action, all right? So this is the, so forget about this part. If there is no this part, this is the classical combinational logic circuit. So here are the inputs. If here we have our circuit, so depending on the input, we have the output. So this is the classical combinational logic design that we talked about all the past, all right? So we will have another concept here. It is the memory concept. So memory means basically the flip-flops, all right? Basically the flip-flops, or say generally it's the memory element. Whenever you add some kind of memory element and the input of the memory element comes from the combinational logic, then the past value is fed back to the combinational circuit, all right? And the past value, or say it's the present value, is named as states, all right? And the next value is the next state. All right, so depending on the time, there will always some kind of sequential procedures depending on the state. All right, we will talk about in more detail as a solid circuit, working circuit. So the only difference or the main difference is this part of the classical part. We will add these flip-flop or memory elements to our circuit working style. So as a result, the input of our combination logic circuit is input plus new kind of inputs. What are these new kind of inputs? Outputs of the memories, or formally the outputs of memories named as states or present states, right? Okay. So there are two kinds of concepts in sequential design, all right? So two kinds of approach in sequential design. One is asynchronous sequential design, and the other one is the synchronous sequential design, okay? So asynchronous sequential design is a very special type of circuit design technique, and it's quite difficult, and we are lucky that most of the time we do not use asynchronous sequential circuits. Normally we do not use. We need to have a very important reason to use the asynchronous circuit design, topology design, because this is a quite difficult design process. Difficult means there are lots of hazards that our circuit malfunctions, doesn't function at all. All right? All right? Is there anyone, any question?
Wondering how does it solve it?
Any question, guys?
Daddy. Daddy.
No? Only noise?
Sometimes
do you have any question? Okay, welcome Afan. We know that Afan is available. Okay, good. All right. Let's go. So in this concept, what we learn, at least at first sight, asynchronous sequential design is not the main path. There are very specific circuits that we need asynchronous, but usually we don't need it. There are very complicated design tasks. So as we are engineers, or we will be engineers, time to market is important, fast design is important, fail-safe design is important. So all those things mix up. We need to have a strong way of designing circuits. So it is the synchronous sequential circuit design, all right? But how do we synchronize? How do we synchronize all our circuits? Or if my question, we have cell phone, right? Or we have our computer. Most of the time, what kind of sequential circuits we have in our laptop or in our cell phone? Synchronous or asynchronous? Any comment about it? Anyone? Any answer? No idea. Okay. So I talked about previously that we, most of them, as electronics engineers or design engineers or computer engineers, most of the time, we use synchronous sequential circuits. So that our cell phones, our laptops, or any of the complicated digital logic elements, all more than 99%, almost all of them have synchronous sequential circuit design style, all right? And what synchronize it? The synchronization is made by the clock signal, okay? So sometimes we hear that our laptop works at 2 gigahertz, okay? Or our cell phone speed, CPU speed is 1.5 gigahertz, okay? Or gigahertz, how you pronounce it, okay? So this gigahertz thing is the clock signal, all right? It means that all the circuits are synchronized by using a main clock signal, and it have a specific working frequency. And in today's world, like nowadays, it is like in the gigahertz range in contemporary fifth logic design. All right, it's a very high speed. So we talk about gigahertz frequency. In normal designs, average design, we generally deal with megahertz, all right? But it depends on your performance requirements, of course. It depends. Okay, so here it is the remark that we will only consider the synchronous circuits in this class, all right? So most of the time we will face the synchronous, and we will see the details and differences. Okay. So all synchronous circuits need some kind of clock signal, all right? So that clock signal is a periodic signal that is on and off, or here, this is the logic. This part is the logic 0. This part is the logic 1. And then this part is the logic 0. And 1 again. And it goes on continuously, all the time the same, all right? So this is the clock signal, guys, all right? And the frequency is measured by this period, you measure the period of this signal, and 1 over this period, or 1 over this time, duration, is the clock frequency. All right, it's named as hertz. All right, clock frequency is 1 over t, and is called as hertz. 1 megahertz means that this is 1 microseconds, okay? 1 over 1 microseconds is 1 million hertz. It means that 1 megahertz. All right, so in synchronous logic design, all the state transitions, all the changes occur in this clock rising or falling edges. So we don't care about all elements. We only care about the edge of the signal. Edge means that transition from 0 to 1, all right? Transition from 0 to 1 is named as rising edge, and transition from 1 to 0 is named as negative edge, all right? Usually, most of the synchronous logic elements are working based on a positive edge flip-flop or negative edge flip-flop. Most of the time, it's not both, all right? So when you design, first you decide that your circuit will be triggered by this positive edge, positive means transition from 0 to 1, or we decide that it works from the negative edge, it means that it is the transition from 1 to 0. So this is the clock signal shortly, all right? So this signal synchronize all our sequential circuit devices. Sometimes there are like 100,000 or thousands of flip-flops, and all of these flip-flops are controlled by this simple signal. We connect all elements to this signal in order to synchronize our whole logic design. All right? So the clock edge, what we are interested in, is named as the active edge of the clock. All right? So shortly, latches and flip-flops are the basic building blocks of sequential circuits. Usually, latches are used for the asynchronous design. We will talk about the latches because we most of the time develop the flip-flops by using latches. However, in contemporary logic design, we only use the flip-flops, okay? So the flip-flops and latches have two states, biostable means two states, zero states, and one state. We will talk about it. Okay. Okay. So we will start with the latch element. Latch or flip-flop, all are the memory elements, all right? So in order to hold the information, we need to have some kind of feedback in our circuit mechanism, okay? So as you see, we have the output. What we do with this output, we feedback this output to the input. So this is the set and reset, flip set and reset type latch, or FR latch. FR means set and reset, all right? And we have a feedback from output to input, and be careful what happens, okay? Whenever I want to set the output, I trigger some kind of set signal over here, okay? I trigger something to set. Set means making one, okay? So whenever I make one this part, all right? Whenever I make this part one, if this is the NOR gate, if this is one, regardless of this, here, the output of the OR gate will be one, and since this is the inverse of that one, this will be zero. Okay? So I will input zero to here, all right? I will input zero to here. So zero and zero means that since there is no reset available, zero and zero means that the output of the OR gate is zero, then since it is inverted, so it becomes one over here, all right? It means that I triggered once, then the output is what? Whenever I, for one microsecond, I input a set signal, the output is set, all right? It means the output become one. After, whenever I remove the set, it remembers that previously it was set, all right? So it's like, you know, the old washing machine or some kind of simple machine that whenever you press the start button, or let's come to the today's technology, whenever you press the start engine of the of your car, if it is a modern car, when you press your hand on the button and remove it, then it starts running, okay? Okay? When it will become zero? Even I remove my hand from the set switch, set button, it is all the time one, it is running, okay? When shall it be zero? Any comment from yours? No comment at all? Okay. So, my friend, not when you press it again. However, you are close. Since this is the set button, all right, there is another button. It is the reset button, okay? So you will not press same, but press the reset button, all right? Whenever you press the reset button, let's see what happens. Whenever I plug one to here, then one, whatever it is, the output of the OR gate will be one. Since it is inverted, I am sure that then it is zero. Then It is fed back to the system. For the system is always, it has the feedback mechanism. Whenever I remove my hand from the reset button, it will continuously stay zero. Until what? Until I press the set button again. So this is the simplest type of memory element that it remembers what I pressed previously. It is done by the very simple feedback mechanism with this cross coupling. Please, at home, you try to propagate the signals from set and reset. So you imagine that you plug one to hear what happens and plug reset and what happens. Okay, you try by yourself. Okay. And the symbol of this FR latch is like that. So whenever you see this symbol, you don't need to look for the circuitry inside. Whenever you see this, it means it is the FR latch element, FR memory element, and this is the output. And what is Q bar? Of course, the Q bar is the inverse of this Q. Okay. So there is an advantage of this circuit that the inverse of the output is simultaneously available together with the output. Okay. So we have the characteristic table for these memory elements. Okay. So this one is in detail. This is the short form. This is the short form. As you see, whenever there is no input, what is at the output? What is it at the output? It is the previous output, okay? However, whenever I only press the reset button, the output will be zero, regardless of any kind of previous state of the throughout. And whenever I press set button and don't touch the reset button, it will become one, all right? Yes, you press, you touch the button, it means that you plug one to each of them. When you touch the reset button only once, the output will be zero. When you touch the set button only once, it will be one. When you touch both of the inputs, start and stop at the same time, then it is not defined. You can, it is forbidden, okay? You never press both. So what happens? What happens, we don't know, okay? What happens, whichever we remove first, the other will dominate. So if kind of condition is not defined. All right, here is another kind of realization of the FR latch. It is the same function, all right, but it is done with the NAND gate. So in more advanced circuit designs, all right, in more advanced circuit designs, in order to be safe from any kind of hazards, we also have kind of gate input or enable input. So it's like a clutch in your car that you don't change your transmission without pressing the clutch in your car, right? So this kind of, there in some advanced circuits, there are some kind of mechanism that you first apply effort the gate input. It means that you make the input one, then you decide what to do. Without this gate input, if you apply anything, nothing will happen. Okay, then you first effort a one to the gate input, then you do whatever you do, then you have the same function. Okay. So guys, before I finish, listen, please start reading also the document in your book related to the chapter of the sequential logic elements chapter. All right. All right. So I will not go on very further today. We will keep at the starting point. All right. So let's go on some more time, and then you study at home. Okay. So this is the characteristic table of the gated FR latch, or the latch, same latch with the gate input. So as you see, whenever the gate is one, it is the same. Okay. It is the same as the previous. However, whenever the gate input is zero, nothing happens. The output remains the same. Okay. Here is the gated D-latch. Okay. So D-latch means that sometimes we don't need to set and reset the circuit, but we have the data, whether it is zero or one. And then what we do, we need to keep our data, okay? So it is this way. This is the characteristic table of the D-latch, okay? Or gated D-latch. It means that whenever the gate input is one, okay, the output is transparent. Means that if I make the input zero, the output is zero. If I make the input one, the output is one. Whenever I remove this gate input, then the output freezes. Okay. So if I use this D-latch element is an important design element of logic circuit, the whole logic design idea. Okay. So if I use an array of D-latches, like 8 of it at the same time, it means that I have an 8-bit register. If I use 32 of it, I have a 32-bit of register. So our computers are mostly based on register elements, all right? So then register means you register, you keep your data. Usually our data is 32-bit, 64-bit, or sometimes in small computers, smaller values like 16 bits. So all our data is kept inside a memory element named as D-type latch, all right? So this D-latch is a quite fundamental element of our logic design style, okay? All right, guys, please read the topic by yourself, the start of this chapter in your book. I don't want to make you tired today. So after, let's meet together next time to discuss it in more detail. Is there any question? Any question at all? Okay. Thank you very much for listening. We will meet next time, hopefully. Okay. See you all, everyone.